Hello, and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Bradley Fisher. I'm an educational technology director and computer science educator at the elementary school level. It is my pleasure to bring you to the 16th webinar in this series hosted by NCWIT Counselors for Computing. Each month, we connect you with thought leaders at the cutting edge of technology. This series offers a unique opportunity to dive into the intersection of computer science with traditional and non-traditional STEM fields, also known as CS plus X. Throughout the presentation, we would love for you to submit questions through the Q&A feature on the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. We will also be sharing resources in the chat feature, also found on the toolbar at the bottom of the screen. The National Center for Women and Information Technology, or NCWIT, is a nonprofit community of more than 1,500 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. NCWIT equips change leaders with resources for taking action in recruiting, retaining, and advancing women across the entire computing ecosystem. Before NCWIT, programs focusing on women and computing existed mostly in isolation without the benefit of shared best practices, effective resources, communication with others, or national reach. Today, these programs are part of the NCWIT community, creating a far greater impact than if institutions acted alone. NCWIT Counselors for Computing, or C4C, program provides information and resources to help counselors join the front line of the computing conversation. We bring people and programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to transformative computing careers. We wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM, the largest employer of scientists and engineers in the nation. DoD STEM offers educational programs, internships, and scholarships for students and many career development opportunities for educators. We shared their website in the chat for you to learn more. I would now like to introduce you to our speaker, Dr. Lauren Cooper. Dr. Cooper is a teaching associate professor in the Western Colorado University CU Boulder Partnership Program and an associate director of the program. Throughout this program, students earn CU Boulder mechanical engineering degrees while living and going to school in Gunnison, Colorado. Prior to her current position, Dr. Cooper was an assistant professor at Cal Poly San Luis Obispo in mechanical engineering. Her research interests include engineering education, student motivation, project-based learning, and outdoor industry engineering. Dr. Cooper earned her MS in building systems engineering and her PhD in mechanical engineering, both from CU Boulder. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Cooper.
Thank you for having me. I'll share my slide. Again. Okay, well, thank you for the introduction. Yes, as Bradley said, I am from this partnership program, which is a really unique program that I was very excited to be invited to share to you all in today's webinar. And we offer both computer science and engineering degrees. So I thought a lot of attendees are more focused on getting students ready for CS careers, that even though I'm a mechanical engineer, I'm a partnership program faculty, and I can speak to opportunities in computer science that we offer through this partnership program. So I think Bradley kind of hit the high points. I have been teaching for a while. I've taught at CU Boulder, I've taught at Cal Poly, taught at Colorado School of Mines. Now I'm at Western Colorado University in Gunnison. Most of my industry experience has been in the energy field. So I've done some work with NREL. And another kind of thing I wanted to mention about me is I'm really passionate about engineering outreach, which is why I was so happy to do this webinar and have a conversation with you all. So how that looks for me these days in terms of engineering outreach, I piloted and started a 6-week engineering program here in the Gunnison Valley for middle school students that's been pretty successful. And we're looking at expanding opportunities for not just engineering, but getting the local kids involved in computer science as well. So this is just a picture from last summer. Kind of my personal background, I have 2 little kids, so it's always pretty chaotic at my house. I love the outdoors. My background right now, I am not actually sitting in a flowery field, but this is the Crested Butte Valley, the Gunnison Valley, and I'm just so happy and I think fortunate to be in such a place that, although it's isolated, it's very beautiful. And I heard that there were some attendees from Nevada. So whenever I know that, I like to point out that I was born in Reno. So hello to anyone else on this webinar who's from Nevada and maybe even Reno. So I've taught in different places, Cal Poly, CU Boulder, Colorado School of Mines, and they're all great universities, but I wouldn't be giving a presentation to you about those universities because they're just kind of like all the other universities. But I really wanted to share with you information about the partnership program because it is so unique. And I will totally get to the stuff about outdoor industry engineering and computer science. But first, I just wanted to share this opportunity that you might share with your students for earning a engineering degree in a place that maybe people haven't heard about. So Gunnison, Colorado. It's kind of right here on the map, never had the name, but it's right in the middle of the Rocky Mountains. So we are about 3.5 hours southwest of Denver. If we could drive to Aspen, which is a beautiful ski area, it would be about 1 hour as the crow flies, but there are many mountains, so have to go around. Population is small and the elevation is high. So that's a little bit about where I am located and where this program is located. I had some pictures that I was going to show about just Western University in general. And then I remembered that we recently did an episode on college tour. And if I can navigate Zoom controls, I wanted to play just this 1-minute video clip with you that might give you a good sense of what it looks like here, what the campus is like, et cetera. So just take me a moment.
The Rocky Mountains in the beautiful located on the western slope of the Rocky Mountains in the beautiful Gunnison Valley. Western Colorado University is a public college where students engage in rigorous immersive learning in some of the wildest and most compelling landscapes imaginable. The size of Western creates a culture of self-discovery and a place where academic pursuits, relationship building, and community engagement come together to create students and alumni who love to call this valley home. I'm your host, Alex Boylan, and over the next half hour, we're going to explore Western, the town of Gunnison, Colorado, and this incredible valley. We'll meet current students and some successful alumni and hear their stories about what creates the magic that Gunnison Valley is so known for. Welcome to Western Colorado University. This is the College Tour.
Okay, so that kind of brings, hopefully gives you an idea of what Gunnison looks like. I'm curious. I don't know if we can pause and have a moment in the chat. If anyone has been to Gunnison or Crested Butte. Well, besides being beautiful, there is a really cool opportunity here. It's called the Partnership Program, and it is a partnership between CU Boulder, the big university, and Western Colorado University, which is small. So we offer both mechanical engineering degrees and computer science degrees. So a little bit about how this works. The first 2 years of courses students take as a full-time Western Colorado University student. So they get like a small campus experience, lots of support. So these courses are math, physics, chemistry, gen ed, et cetera. And they pay Western tuition and have lots of access to Western scholarships. So the first 2 years are really great cost savings for students. And then the second 2 years of courses are taken here in Gunnison, but they become CU Boulder students. So they transfer to CU Boulder, and it's a formal transfer process. We help them through it. So they either do their degrees then in computer science or mechanical engineering. So they remain physically located in Gunnison the entire time, and it ends up being close to a 40% tuition cost savings for students. So that's one of the reasons that this partnership program was formed. There are two here from CU Boulder. One is in a town called, a city called Grand Junction, and that's about 11 years old. But this one here in Gunnison is about 3 years old. So it's quite new. So these partnership programs are only a handful, I think, across the United States. But for us, for our program, it really is the best of both worlds. So students do get a top-ranked engineering school in Colorado, which is CU Boulder, but they get to enjoy small class sizes and low student to faculty ratios. We're an amazing location, and we do lots with the community here because it is a small town. So there's a lot to do in a small town. I had never lived in a small town before moving to Gunnison about a year ago. I'd always been in big cities like Reno and in California. So this has been a really cool experience for me to start to understand the importance of community when you live in a small town in an isolated area. We have a lot of collaborative elective options, which I'll talk about a little bit later. We have a thriving honors program and minors and study abroad, which I will touch on later. We really focus on project-based hands-on experiential education for both mechanical engineering and computer science. And our CS focus specifically, since I know that is the audience, is on machine learning, data science, and programming languages. So just a little bit about, like, if you were pitching this to students, like why get a CU Boulder degree? It's a state school, yes, but it is the 15th public undergraduate ranking, or the 15th public, it's earned this ranking for mechanical engineering. According to the statistics that they gather, 91% of graduates are employed within 6 months of graduation. They have a high transfer rate to graduate school, a good salary, a good starting salary post-graduation. There is a really, I'd say, a really, really thriving and involved network of CU Boulder Engineering alumni. And then, of course, the degree is accredited via ABET, and you need that ABET accreditation if you want to pursue like a professional engineering degree. So right now we just have the two degrees, mechanical engineering and computer science. Starting in fall 2024, we will be launching a biomed program, biomedical engineering program, and an aerospace engineering program. So there is a lot of interest, there's a lot of funding and support for this partnerships program, and really a lot of that funding and support trickles down to the students. So mechanical engineering, the most versatile and flexible engineering major in the class. I mean, these pictures I took, these are my students. This is Vicky and this is Ryan. I have had them in class. I'll have had them straight through for 2 years because we are so small. So I get to know the students really well. We focus on working as a team, lots of hands-on and experiential experiences. And then we really try to, we do research, but we're not a research focused faculty. We're all teaching faculty. So none of us are vying for tenure here, which is wonderful. So we don't have big research agendas. So we choose high impact research. So I'll talk more about our outdoor industry niche research area here. So careers, I think this is helpful if you're talking to your students about what kind of careers can you do with mechanical engineering. Mention things like robotics, manufacturing, renewable energy, automotive, biomechanics, and of course, outdoor industry engineering. Of course, not an extensive list, but those are some of the main career pathways. And then computer science, this is our smaller program. So we have, I think, 20 partnership students who are earning their degrees in the first through fourth years total in computer science. So it is a new and growing program, which is awesome because we have lots of seats for students you might be able to send our way. But same thing, the CS faculty are wonderful here. They really also focus on interdisciplinary and collaborative learning, real world problem solving, new technologies and programming languages. So again, talking to students about careers, robotics, artificial intelligence, machine learning, and software engineering. The next slide I'm going to show, I've talked about our program being unique. I think this is one of the most unique aspects of the faculty. Six out of our 9 faculty members are women, which is amazing. It's really, really different for an engineering program. I came from Cal Poly and I thought that was my dream job. And I was really, really close to getting my tenure. And I had worked so hard and made so many sacrifices, that I look back on and wish I could have that hour, that 2 hours with my kids instead of trying to climb the ladder like I was. But it was just a completely male-dominated department and program. And I never felt like I had space for my creativity. And I'm a real entrepreneurial person by nature. And it just felt really stifled. And I'd say the same thing about teaching at Colorado School of Mines. So wonderful institutions, but this has allowed me, and I hope our students, a place to thrive and be who we are. So it's just great to have so many women in leadership positions. And I love that our CS and mechanical engineering students are seeing us as their role models, as their leaders too. So some of the emphasis areas we have: management, entrepreneurship, robotics, biomechanics, outdoor industry, environment and sustainability. We have a really cool product development track, advanced data science and artificial intelligence. And then we have this cool collaboration with the business school here. So students can do a 4+1 program. So 4 years as an undergrad and then 1 year as a master's student and a little bit of overlap to earn an outdoor industry MBA program or outdoor industry MBA through this program. So I'm sure this is pretty common to what a lot of you do, and thank you for that. But we also really try to continue the students' professional development. We do workshops, we do career fairs and industry tours. We do all this even though we're quite small. We do have a lot of resources for students, and it's great that we can give such kind of like targeted and personalized advice and mentoring in the professional development realm. I'm gonna pause here and say that almost 40% of our students have self-identified as coming from first generation families. So they're their first in their family to attend college, which quite honestly was a different, I had to teach differently. It was really, eye-opening coming from Cal Poly, where I could just post an assignment and say, okay, go do it. And I got here and I would do the same thing. And I quickly realized that there were other aspects that I needed to teach to. There's more than I needed to do than just try to motivate a student by a carrot or a grade. So this has just been such a tremendous opportunity for me to grow as an educator as well. So areas of emphasis and options within the degree programs that we have, I talked about engineering management. CS also has the engineering management and entrepreneurship. We have honors programs, so students can earn certificates, writing, Spanish, philosophy. One of the clubs that I would like to point out that I think is really unique to our program is a student-formed club. It's called Mountaineers Without Borders. And it's kind of a play on the big national club called, or I guess it's an international club or organization, Engineers Without Borders. We wanted to start something smaller. So we started Mountaineers Without Borders. And through that, club, I'm taking 12 students to do a project with the community that we've been working with in Colombia for 2 weeks this summer. So we hope to start offering these international kind of study abroad trips in conjunction with Mountaineers Without Borders. So just some of our elective course offerings. We offer electives in biomedical engineering, sustainability, entrepreneurship, and data science. And although I know that biomedical engineering and sustainability might be more related to mechanical engineering, the data science electives are certainly applicable to CS students as well as the entrepreneurship. Getting more toward what the title of the talk is, outdoor industry engineering, we thought about this, so that a team thought about, like, well, how can we, like, what's going to be our kind of the way that we stand out, and how are we going to attract students, both CS and mechanical? Like, well, where are we? We're in this beautiful place. We like to ski. We like to be outside. Our students like to ski, to snowboard, to kayak, to mountain bike. So why don't we try to do something with outdoor industry engineering? So this started as a summer research program. Last summer, it was very popular. We got a lot of applicants, and we even got some international applicants, which was exciting. We had students from both our partnership at Western and CU Boulder work together, and two-thirds of the students, or two of them, from CU Boulder transferred to the partnership program. So what outdoor industry engineering, I have a video in a minute, but what that kind of encompasses is testing of, like, ski profiles. Can we build apparatus that tests and kind of quantifies the bending rigidity of skis, or how much a mountain bike wheel deforms on impact? I'm personally looking into technical apparel. So waterproof jackets, waterproof pants, and designing new ways of testing technical apparel. So we really pride ourselves, or we really strive to get 100% of our students, both in CS and mechanical, to have an internship after their 4 years, so at some point. So one statistic, 91% of employers prefer to hire students who have relevant experience. So we have at this point, like, 95% internship placement for a graduating class. So what I'm trying to say, and what I love about this program, and what I really want one of the take homes about this program to be for you, is that students walk through the door and they matter. Every student really matters here. And we'll never grow too big where we can't really help find internships for students and really take the time to do professional development, et cetera. We also, our elective list that I showed, a lot of these came from student interests, from focus groups, like, okay, what do you want to see? Because you want to learn more about machine learning. Great, let's try to create an elective. Let's find someone maybe in the community who can adjunct and teach this class if, like, internally our team can't do it. But that's a lot of how these electives came to be. So student feedback is very important for us. So this is a really cool video. I will fumble with Zoom again, but this is our outdoor mountain bike testing lab that we built up in the mountains of Crested Butte, kind of like my background, it's up in the mountains there. It's we couldn't get to it right now because it's very snowy where I am right now. But we built this cool mountain bike track, and we're already having quite a few bike companies contact us and ask, hey, can you test our mountain bike wheels? And what that means for us is money for projects and money for students, which is amazing. So try to find this video.
Well, we are here on a gorgeous day in the Gunnison Valley. Greg, what are we up to?
We're here to test mountain bike wheels. So we're at the closed course that we developed to test wheels. And so what we did is we built several features that most riders are going to want to see, and then we can put these wheels through their paces. So we have some tight S turns, some banked corners. We have some rock features. Got one that you can go big on if you want to. You could roll it if you care, and that puts you into a rock garden. And so the goal is to try to mimic what most riders are going to put their wheels through, because real world applicability to this testing is kind of the backbone of what we're doing. And so the goal is to measure in the field things like displacement, force. What are these wheels seeing with your typical rider? So we're going to vary the rider, we're going to vary the obstacle, and we're going to vary the wheels and see what we get.
And we should say, lots of folks perhaps are doing certain testing in a laboratory.
Yep.
Then folks like what we do at Blister, we get out in the field and establish our kind of qualitative experiences with wheel sets, yeah, etc. But we're marrying these things now, right? Yeah. So talk a little bit about how we're kind of bringing the laboratory into the field.
Yeah, I mean, I think long form qualitative reviews as well as laboratory testing, both of those are excellent and you need those. But one of the things that we think is missing is, you know, wheels see complex loading. So you're riding it through a rock garden or you're going over a jump. It's not just what you're seeing in the laboratory. So we want to test this under real world loading scenarios, and we want to see things like displacement. How much are these moving in X, Y, and Z? How are they responding? Because those are performance metrics that I think the end user is going to be really interested in.
Yep. And to that end, what we're doing is using lots of sensors,
yep,
pretty sophisticated camera system. And so we are capturing this stuff, and then we'll be able to analyze that quantitative data and see how that is lining up and perhaps helping us to get the lab tests to be more realistic in terms of realistic loading forces and, yeah, what are those ranges like?
Yeah, all of this is information that we're collecting that we can circle back. You know, all testing procedures, good ones, are circular. So you learn from the field, you learn from the lab, you learn from qualitative long-form reviews, and these change the way that you're testing and reviewing wheels. And so here we're gathering a lot of data real time, and we're seeing microscopic movement of wheels in X, Y, and Z based off of these different scenarios that we're pushing these bikes through.
So for the typical rider who is like, that all sounds nice and fancy, why should I care about this?
Yeah, well, there's a lot of great wheels out there, but which one is right for you? I think we all understand that there's some amazing products, but which one fits your riding style? Which one fits the type of trails that you like to be on? Because they're gonna have different feel, different character, and a lot of people know this already from long form reviews and all of that, but can we quantify that? Can we say that a typical rider of this size, this riding, how aggressive are you? This is the force range that you would be in. Based off of that force range, this is how this wheel or that wheel would respond to that, right? Because wheels are gonna perform differently under different force bands, and what are those, right? Those are one of the top questions that we're trying to answer.
And now to learn more about all the things that we have going on.
Okay, so I get back to my slides. I only have a couple left. At first glance, it might seem like those projects are focused on mechanical engineering because they involve components and forces and you know, mechanical things, but there's so much data acquisition. So we're really finding that we are having to work together, mechanical engineers and computer science students, to really figure this all out. So totally applicable to computer science students who are interested in this, you know, this type of computer science. So I just have a couple more slides and then have a, you know, time for discussion. I just wanted to, yeah, like just two more slides. The whole reason this partnership program came to be and came to be so successful as it's been, we received, this was before I was hired, a $100 million donation from Paul Rady. He's actually an alumni of Western Colorado University. He wanted to see this opportunity for engineering and computer science brought to the Western Slope of Colorado. So his donation built the building. We have state-of-the-art labs. We have amazing equipment. It is far beyond what I ever had access to. Even at Cal Poly, it topped, you know, top-rated engineering school. It's pretty mind-blowing. And it's just kind of a, you know, just one of those big donations that could have never happened, so we could easily never be here. But with his donation came a lot of scholarship money for students that will happen every year. So he has committed to providing scholarship funds for students. So that's why it's called the Rady Merit Scholarship. We have like a tiered GPA. I think it's kind of new, but students coming in with, you know, 3.5 to 3.75 are eligible for $3,500 off their tuition, and then an out-of-state $9,000, and it kind of ratchets up from there, which is amazing. And then I feel like probably people on this call know more about the WUI Central Plains tuition discount program than I do, but WUI gives significant tuition discounts for certain states. And what's interesting is that CU Boulder, the main campus CU Boulder, those students aren't eligible for these WUI tuition discounts, but the Western students are. So combined with some of the Rady Merit scholarships that we give, make this program super affordable. So it has all of the, it checks all the boxes for me in terms of like a program that I feel really good about being a part of. We focus on underrepresented students. First gen is mostly what I mean by, I guess, underrepresented students. We are in a rural location. We do a lot to serve the rural community. I'm taking my freshman on 3 engineering service trips this semester because there's a local school here who needs help installing their playground equipment. So there's just always ways to incorporate service. And we're mostly women. So it's such a unique program. And again, if I were still at Cal Poly, I wouldn't have shown you 29 slides about Cal Poly, but this is just a gem of a program. So I wanted to share it with you. And I know the slides will be shared. There's just a lot of marketing and media that we've received throughout the last year. There's a really cool story. Out of all of these things, if I were going to read or recommend one thing, this story in the Denver Post was really, really cool about the partnership program and bringing engineering and computer science to a rural location. So that's that Denver Post article here. Those are all the slides I have, and I think we have plenty of time for some Q&A or panelist questions. So thank you for your attention and listening and participating by being here.
Thank you very much, Dr. Cooper. That sounds like an amazing program. I wish I was 18 again and could fashion a career around outdoor adventure and technology. So very cool. So we do have a few questions for you. First one is, what do your student demographics look like? Are these programs accessible to students from low-income families, especially ones from out of state? Obviously, you covered some of that, but if you would like to speak to additionally.
The WUI combined with the Rady Merit Scholarship makes this very financially feasible for students, even out of state. The one thing that they're not career counselors, but we have this really fantastic team of advisors, and they help the students think through the 4 years because they do have to pay more tuition. They have to pay the CU Boulder tuition for the third and the fourth year if they want to remain in the program because they become CU Boulder students. So I think the advice is along the line of, you're saving a lot these first 2 years, but you have to like maybe think of the costs for the whole 4 years and split them up over the 4 years. So you're trying to save. And I know this isn't a lot of money, but any student who wants to work here can have a job in our shop, in our spaces. So we are always looking for students. I mean, so many of our students are work in the shop, they're TAs, they're student assistants. So we try, we really try as best we can. It's, I mean, if we could fix it here, we could fix it everywhere, like the cost of tuition. But those first 2 years, the cost savings is really significant. And I can, if anyone's interested, the woman who has the like more polished spiel about the tuition is Laurel Fisher, and I can share her contact information.
Terrific. Just looking to see if there's any other questions.
Oh, but the demographics. So almost 20% first gen. We don't have many students of color. Gunnison is itself not. It's a pretty white community, and that's we actually just had a strategic goals meeting right before this webinar, and that was across the board. We did an anonymous survey, like what are our strategic goals, and number one was to increase representation by women and other underrepresented groups beyond the first gen.
Awesome. Thank you. Next question. Any recommendations for students on how to prepare in high school for this type of program?
Yeah. So we have some specific, they're not hard requirements, but being calc ready, being able to take calc once you enter university is one of those. Sure. Trying to fulfill any humanities credits that might transfer over, not a requirement. The entering GPA of students who begin in the partnership program, the bar is significantly lower than what they would need to enter a CU Boulder main campus degree. So that's another high point of accessibility. So the admissions aren't as stringent. I'm sure there's not an essay, but I'd say the big ones are being calc ready and, getting any of the AP classes out of the way. But it really isn't at this point in time, because we are new. We're not trying to weed people out. We're trying to bring people in, and we want diverse students, and we have the capability and the resources to do, high quality mentoring so that they can go from their second year to their third year, and they want to stay here and they want to be in the program. We are like 1000% not a weed out program. It's just so against how we teach and who we are as educators.
That's great to know. It sounds super student focused and student friendly. One other question, what got you interested in engineering? What was your middle and high school career like? Were you in engineering courses then, or did you get involved with them later?
I feel like no one's going to believe this story, but it is true. So I really wanted to be a writer. I love to write. I love creative writing. I love storytelling. And I applied to two writing schools. And then my dad said, as a backup, why don't you apply to something else? And almost as a joke, decided like, okay, fine, I'll apply to engineering, whatever that is, at Cal Poly. I did not get accepted to the writing school, sadly. I don't not know why. But I got accepted to Cal Poly Engineering. So I went because I just wanted to get away from my house. Because I did not major in engineering in high school. I definitely majored in like other high school extracurriculars, not academics. And I loved engineering because it was just a different way of looking at the world, and it provided an escape from what was probably a really chaotic life for me at that time. So I know that having a strong math and science background is preferred, but it doesn't have to be the pathway. It really doesn't. I think I took calculus in high school. I must have. I don't remember it, but I really didn't fall in love with engineering until later in life. So, and it took me 6 years to get my undergraduate degree. So I wasn't super prepared for college. So I have a lot of empathy for students who either don't want to be on the four-year track, or it's too much and they want to go a little bit slower. And I'm really grateful that I did, and I'm glad that I can speak with authenticity to, really struggling to find my way.
Absolutely. Thank you for that. We have another question. Your journey is exactly what we want our students to know, and the world is open to it. That the world is open to them. What would you suggest we tell our students who aren't sure what they want to do?
Okay, this sounds so cliche, but this is what I tell my students too, because my graduating seniors are like, what are we going to do once we get our degree? And I know there are a lot of barriers. Like, you can't just say, like, do what makes you happy. And we have lots of systemic barriers in our society. We can't just all do what makes us happy. But from looking back, what I've found interesting are the things that make me happy today are the same things that made me happy when I was an 18-year-old. So if you're just kind of making choices that are kind of turning the needle in the direction of, yeah, you might be like maturing and trying to make a better life for yourself, but you still have your eye on what makes you happy and intrinsically motivated. I mean, yeah, that's the advice I give them. I don't give them the like, wow, you know, just make sure you have your resume and your cover letter, because when you're happy, you'll do those things and you'll do them with vigor. But it's how are we supposed to know at 18 what we want to do? But we know what makes us happy at 18. Right.
That's great advice. Another question. Was your high school counselor helpful in your journey? How could they have supported you more?
My physics teacher was really helpful in my journey, but nothing with career. I grew up in Reno. So, I mean, I wasn't the best teenager. It was pretty horrible, actually. And I just, you know, I never in school, never in class, didn't care about grades. But it was like my physics teacher who had me sign a contract that I would come to school every day, and he would even buy me lunch twice a week, and we'd sit together and just talk. It didn't even have to be about anything. And I remember Mr. Chambers so well. And maybe because I went to a big public school in Reno, we just didn't have resources like career counselors, but mm-hmm. I'd say my mentor when I was an undergraduate was really, really helped me a lot. There were two times that I had come to the conclusion, because engineering is hard, and I know I wasn't coming into it with all this like going to STEM camp or robotics camp. I was like a kid from Reno, you know, just trying to hack it. I couldn't do it. I felt dumb. I wasn't, you know, like I was so happy if I got like a B. So I was going to drop out, and I came to his office to have him sign the form, and he didn't tell me no. He didn't say he wasn't going to find the form, but he signed the form, but he just started talking to me about what I was going to do. And I said, well, I'm going to move to Costa Rica. Like 22. I'm going to move to Costa Rica with my boyfriend. And I don't know the rest of the sentence. And he said, wow, there's a program called Engineering World Health that you would go to Costa Rica for a month, and you would learn how to speak Spanish, and you would learn how to refurbish medical equipment. And then for the last part of the summer, you would be working in a rural hospital. Would you give that a try if I, you know, maybe helped read over your application? And I like, well, yeah, I'm going to go to Costa Rica anyway. So I did that program, and it was so amazing. It was one of the first times where I felt that I made a difference in the world. I also, through that experience, understood the complexity of how technical problems aren't just technical. There's a whole socio-technical element of problems that needs to be considered when we're even defining engineering and computer science problems to solve. So what it did for me is that I felt like I mattered. Someone cared about me. Someone didn't want me to drop out enough that they found this program for me and helped me apply. And three, I saw that engineering wasn't just about the math. It was about the people and the problem definition. So yeah, it just takes that one person. And I try to remember that, like, it just takes that maybe sometimes that one person to care. And I know if you're on this call, probably that person, because you're taking the time to listen to these webinars.
Yeah, I'm sure that's going to resonate with.
And I hear stories. I hear stories from my life. I hear stories from college students about their amazing high school teacher or their amazing career guidance counselor. And it does matter.
Absolutely. You know, it's great to hear a story from someone who wasn't, you know, on the honor roll since kindergarten, you know, kind of ending up where you are in the career path and now helping others along the way as well. So Dr. Cooper, thank you so much for the fascinating and informative talk that you gave today. I think that's all the questions that we have time for. We hope that you'll join us for our next webinar on February 21st, or you can view past webinars by going to the link in the chat. Finally, look out for a survey in your email within the next few days. Responding to the survey will enter you in a drawing for a $100 Amazon gift card and resource kit. We thank you for your responses and for joining us today. We hope to see you at one of our upcoming webinars. Have a good evening, everyone.